So, hopefully I did not forget anything. Put in any more combo boxes. Okay, now, so now we can see those three controls with the labels, and I think the values are correct. So when I check this to set it. So this is basically now displaying parameters completely with the built-in stuff from the library. So it's, I think, relatively simple. Of course, not. Yeah, I don't have much influence now on the appearance here. So, for example, if I wanted to display this as a, not as a checkbox, but as a graphical control with a LED or something, then I would have to do some more modifications.
There's a base class of control where I can read from to get the label and the update sign or something like this. Because I only saw checkbox, combo box, and textbox.
Yes. So what we want to do, but it's currently not possible, is that I could apply some template or some style to those. But you can also. I would maybe not derive, but maybe create a copy, or so take the source code of those controls and just modify it. I think that that's much simpler than to override things. But yeah, so we also want to provide the possibility to do templates, so WPF templates. So. Maybe to do some corporate identity, for example, to change the appearance of the text boxes and things like this.
For the main value that you've made dynamic, so it's constantly reading it, how would you change that poll interval?
Yeah, I can show you how this is done.
Maybe you want different intervals for different.
Yeah. So this dynamic reading is currently actually implemented here in the UI. So the page, first of all, has a timer.
Okay.
And the page gets notifications when it's initialized. So the very first time, when it's loaded and unloaded.
Okay, 3 seconds.
Currently it's a second. So currently we just have one page, but typically you would have more. So when you jump between pages, then you get those notifications here.
Okay, and you could have two timers, one at 10 seconds, one at 1 second, and you could use them for different parameters.
Yeah.
Same.
Yes.
Okay.
You could also, let's say, if many pages have those timers, maybe to save resources, you could also place the timer in the view model for the whole user interface. So here it creates those pages, and each page has access to the main view model. So you could maybe create one timer for the whole UI and then register callbacks or things like this. So there we don't really have a fixed way to do it. It's
okay.
Just so this is just one possibility.
So some variables are dynamic and some are static. Have a way of sorting that out and having a separate timer for each? Or?
Yeah, so currently I only read the ones which are marked as dynamic. So when the timer ticks, so when it gets its tick event, executes a method called refresh cyclic data. So this method creates a read request for all the controls which have this dynamic property, and then sends this read request as a message to the business logic here. And then in the callback, this is done in two steps because we have to do the actual mapping to the view model in the UI thread, because then the data binding is executed. So first, when we get the response from the business logic, it starts another operation to change really to the UI thread here. And then we basically call the process messages. This is implemented in the base class and will update the UI. And then restart the timer. So this is, I like it more like this because, for example, here with this WCF, if we would shut down the server, it takes a long time. Now maybe we can just show this here. Yeah, I can open them. So now we see that it's trying to connect, and this takes a long time because the timeout is quite long until it understands that there is no connection. And if I would have the timer tick every second, the requests would queue up now. Yeah, so of course this is maybe not good in the communication part. Should maybe notice this earlier that it doesn't have a connection. But with this implementation, now it was disturbed. And then 1 second later, of course, it tries to connect again, because the timer is restarted. But if I would just let it tick periodically, I would pile up those requests. And
so the dynamic timer, as it's implemented here, if you had more than one screen, would update all the dynamic variables every second, whether you were showing them or not?
No, so this one is now implemented just in this screen.
Okay.
And when I would select another one, then it basically stops this timer.
Okay, so it won't be updating information you're not looking at.
Yeah. So it's only updating when the screen is or the page is actually visible.
Where is this page control unloaded? Does that mean visible or just open in the background?
Yeah, so it actually, the view model always stays in the memory, but the user control itself is disposed.
Even if you're just not viewing it, so it's still open in the frame, but just not.
And also, this is just those, so the page is this area here. And
the second tab?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if you open the offline parameters,
then it would still continue. So if I open this one now, although this is not visible.
No, it's still running.
It's still running, yeah.
So you have to close the page first.
Yeah. So I can't do that now because I only have one. Sorry? How can it?
How could it queue up a read request if you have no connection?
Yeah, first of all, the messages between the UI and the business logic are queued up. So. So this depends on the implementation of the message handling. So basically we have the UI here. Can you read this or is it too small? And then we have the business logic. And let's say the communication DTM or the channel. So first of all, there's a message sent here from the UI to the business logic, which says, I want to read this parameter. And if the timer ticks every second, then this message is sent every second. So nobody cares about communication problems here. And then here we have this UI message handler. Which receives this message. And then in the case of an online request, it uses some kind of a communication job. To do the actual communication. And now it depends how this is implemented. So if it just processes every request asynchronously or something, then it would also pile up those communication jobs. And then they try to communicate and after 5 seconds get a timeout and then it would go to the next one in the queue. And if this one is implemented so that it handles one request and if another one comes in while this job is still running, maybe throws it away, then it would be okay. But it depends how this is organized.
Then the UI message handler must be very intelligent because it has to wait until the connect request succeeds, get the communication reference, look at all the UI messages, whether there are read requests inside, publish the communication reference to all the read requests, and then execute the read request.
Yeah. This is what it's doing. And it's using this communication job as a helper.
The communication job is responsible to go online and or checks if it's online. Mm. Okay, so that means the framework helps me as a developer to, I can say, please communicate it, and the communication job will be in the background, try to go online and then come back. Oh, it's not possible, then I get the feedback that the job task could not be finished correctly.
Yeah.
How is
it disconnect then
triggered?
I think when the UI is closed or when the offline button is clicked. I'm not 100% sure.
But normally, as long as the UI is open, the connection is still there.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, I think we can see this. So the when the UI is closed, Ah, no, it's not. So it's not in this italic letters anymore. So it probably had actually disconnected. Well, it was never really connected.
So does this add, if you had, you had multiple variables on the screen, is it queuing up all five and requesting a value from the business logic, or is it doing one and waiting for a response to the first one before it goes to the second?
No, it would then do all this, all the five at the same time.
The business logic would have to be smart enough to check to see it as getting repeat messages.
Yeah. Yes.
To, rather than just queue up 100 messages of the same request, it would know that it's actively.
Yes. Yeah. Although here the timer is basically always waiting for the response, and then starts the interval again.
Okay, so it is going to ask them one at a time.
Yeah, so that's how the timer is done here. So it's it restarts the timer only after it got the results from the previous request. Mm-hmm. So this will be then more than 1 second. So the 1 second plus
the request time.
Yeah.
So for wireless, it's more like 15 seconds is a better number.
Yes. Yeah, so but it's the request is asynchronous, so you can still use the page, or you can also change the page while the request is still pending. That's not blocking the UI.
Yep. The communication between the user interface and the business logic goes through the framework. Is this correct?
In this case, yes. So it's using messages. So here we have some predefined messages in the framework.
And this implementation, where is this implementation done of this messaging in this example now?
So maybe we can set some breakpoints to show this. So I will restart the device here. Sorry, I have to. So the first thing is maybe that the timer ticks, or gets a tick event. So then, and here in the UI, at some point we get the response. So we can stop here. And then in the on the business logic side, the messages are handled by this UI message handler. In this case, so each UI has a dedicated message handler. So we can stop here. But it's basically using a base class then to handle the stuff. So now we can see that when we open the UI, there are already some messages. So for example here, initialize request. So these are messages which are predefined in the library. And then register page request, so there's some initialization. We can. So now the timer ticks here in the UI. This creates a get control data request. So that's a message which is defined in the library. And then it loops over the parameters on this page and finds the ones which are marked as dynamic. Here in this call it's called refreshing. So now it found one and adds the ID of this parameter to this read request here.